Okay, welcome back. That's the beginning of our work in progress sessions for today, and it's a great pleasure to introduce Giorgia Romagnoli, who'll speak about the effect of ambiguity on status quo bias, an experimental study. Please.
Okay. So thank you very much for the invitation. This is a joint work with Amnon Maltz, who is a fellow PhD student at NYU. And I'm going to present an experiment on ambiguity and status quo bias. So let's get started. Many choices in real life involve a status quo option. Think, for example, of the revision of your health or retirement plans, or the decision of reallocating your savings into a new investment portfolio, or the decision of moving to a new house. These are all choices that share the same frame, which is one where you either stay with your status quo option or you move away from it. And it has been observed, both in real life choices and with experiments, that such frame may lead to the status quo bias, which is a behavioral bias, which is defined as the tendency of the decision maker to choose the status quo more often than would be predicted by the standard model. So to give substance to this definition, I guess the best way is to show you the results of the canonical experiment on status quo bias, which is by Netsch, 1989. It's a very simple experiment. There, the subjects were divided into two groups. To the first group was simply given the choice between a candy bar and a mug. And it was observed that roughly half of the subjects chose the candy bar and the other half chose the mug. Instead, to the second group, the subjects were first given the candy bar and they were later asked if they wanted to keep it or switch it for the mug. And the results were strikingly different in that 90% of them decided to keep the candy bar, only 10% of them decided to switch. And the status quo bias is all in here, in the difference between 44% and the 90%. In the fact that basically the number of people choosing the candy bar doubled just by virtue of the fact that now the candy bar is in their hand at the time in which they make the choice. So as I was saying, there is a big experimental evidence and also empirical paper that look at real life choices accounting for the presence of the bias. But what is surprising is that the focus of most of the experimental literature has been on physical objects, such as mugs, pens, notebooks, and so on and so forth. And instead, another domain, which is very important, has been somehow neglected by the experimental literature. And I'm talking about the domain of choices under risk and uncertainty. And this is specifically the topic of my talk. What we're after is basically trying to understand if the status quo bias, which is so well observed in the space of candy bars and mugs, is also holding true with the same strength and properties in the space, for example, of risky lotteries and in the space of ambiguous bets. So Simone today gave a very good introduction about the distinction between the two, but let me just summarize it here briefly. We refer to a risky lottery as an object that pays contingent outcomes with some specified probabilities, and we refer to an ambiguous bet as an object paying contingent outcomes with unspecified probabilities. In fact, we will look at the four cases that are born from the interaction between the status quo being either risky or ambiguous and the alternative being either risky or ambiguous. These are the four cases we'll look into: the case of a risky status quo and a risky alternative, the case of a risky status quo and an ambiguous alternative, the opposite case, and finally the case of an ambiguous status quo and an ambiguous alternative. Very good. So the reason why we decided to go with such a general and perhaps repetitive approach is because we believe this is a way in which we can disentangle two families of theories about status quo bias. And this is an interesting comparison because these two theories are not just different from each other in the details, but there is a deeper distinction that looks into the psychological motives behind the bias. So let me explain better what I'm referring to. The first family of theory relates the bias to the idea of loss aversion. So the idea here is that the decision maker is not evaluating his options in isolation, but he evaluates them always with respect to the status quo. So instead of looking at the final outcomes per se, he looks at them in terms of gains and losses with respect to what he would have gotten if he stayed with the status quo. So take, for example, this choice situation here, where the subject is choosing between these two lottery and it has the lottery on the left as his status quo. When he's thinking about switching, he's going to say, okay, one possibility is that this is going to happen, and in this case, I will incur a loss of 15. Another possibility is that this is going to happen, and in this case, I'm going to incur a gain of 15. And the theory of loss aversion believes in the idea that the decision maker is using a distorted value function that distorts gain and losses in the following way. It's going to blow up the losses and distort down the gains, in a way such that at the end of the day, the decision maker will find the status quo his superior option in more situations than he would have under a neutral frame of choice. Clear? Good. So, according to this theory, we should expect the emergence of the bias everywhere in this matrix. Perhaps with different strengths and sizes, but really everywhere in this matrix. Instead, there is a second group of theories that relates the status quo bias to nothing that has to do actually with loss aversion or regret, but rather to the idea of incomplete preferences. This idea first came up with Bewley in 1986 and was later rediscovered and further expanded by Ortoleva. The idea here is that there is an underlying incomplete preference relation, and the decision maker chooses as follows. Every time he can compare two options, he's going to choose according to his preferences. Whereas every time he cannot compare two options, he's going to keep the status quo. Moreover, Bewley's idea is that we only have incompleteness, therefore incomparability between options, under ambiguity. Why is that? Because we cannot compare two options when one is better under some prior and the other is better under some other prior. What it means is that under pure risk, since their priors don't matter, or we only have one prior if you want, there is always one option which is better, therefore their preferences are indeed complete, and therefore in that case there is no really room for the bias to show up. So if that's the correct story behind the status quo bias, then this is what we should expect. Status quo bias everywhere except under pure risk. And by measuring the bias everywhere in this matrix, we will really be able to say whether the theory of loss aversion or the theory of incompleteness is really behind the bias. So let me tell you what we know experimentally, which is surprisingly very little. We are only aware of one paper that looked at the case of an ambiguous status quo and a risky alternative, and it did find status quo bias there. But notice that this finding in isolation is not able, for example, to disentangle the story of loss aversion from the story of incompleteness. And what we are going to do is we are going to fill the matrix everywhere else. Very good. So I'm going to be very brief on the experimental design and details, but please ask me any questions either at the end of the talk or later today. So we are going to adopt a within-subject design where subjects make the same binary choices twice. The first time, they take choices based on a side-by-side comparison between two options. We refer to this in the presentation as the neutral frame. The second time, one option is given to them as endowment, and the subjects are asked if they want to keep it or switch it for the alternative. And we refer to this as the status quo frame. Clearly, what we want to do is we want to track differences in choices between the two frames and see if there is any emergence of the bias. Okay, so let me give you a little bit more details. I'm going to describe to you what happens in the case of a risky status quo and an ambiguous alternatives, but almost everything stays the same in the other treatments. So upon entering the lab, the subjects are described two bags. Bag one is called known, and it has a known composition of chips, 50 white and 50 black. Bag two is called unknown, and it has an unknown composition of chips, in that the subjects only know that there are 100 chips, some are white, some are black, and the number of white chips will be determined only at the end of the experiment by looking at the first two decimals of the Dow Jones. If I have time, I will explain to you why we decided to go with this design instead of using the classic Ellsberg urn. Very good. So part one, neutral frame. The subjects here simply make 15 binary choices between a bet from the known bag, which will be, of course, the risky lottery, and a bet from the unknown bag, which will be the ambiguous bet. The bet from the known bag is actually fixed and is a lottery that pays $10 if white and $4 if black. We will refer to this lottery as the 10-4 lottery in the presentation. Instead, the bets from the unknown bag vary in the 15 questions so that we can elicit preferences over 15 comparisons. This is how a typical question looks like. We describe the composition of the two bags on top. We specify the payoff, and we ask the subjects to pick one between the two. In part two, we are now in the status quo frame. Here, the first thing that happens is that subjects receive an endowment, which is the 10-4 lottery from the known bag that I described earlier. And this is really a physical piece of paper that they have in their hand, describing the lottery, the payoff, and the bag in which the lottery is going to be performed. Later, subjects answer the same 15 questions as in part one, but now the questions are framed differently as a switch from the lottery that they have in their hand to the ambiguous bet, which is described on the question. And they report their answer as a yes or a no to the question, do you want to switch your lottery or not? So this is clearly what we are after. Using their elicited preferences from the neutral frame, we are going to identify a subset of alternatives that the lottery 10-4 is preferred to. And when we later endow the subject with the lottery 10-4, we are going to look, as evidence for the status quo bias, for an expansion of such subset of preferred options. Okay? So before telling you the results, let me zoom out a little bit and tell you what we did in the other treatments. Everything stayed the same, except, of course, the composition of the two bags. So for example, in the risky-risky treatment, we used two bags with known composition, and the ambiguous-ambiguous case, we used two bags with unknown composition. Okay, so now the results. So the first econometric approach we took was we aggregated the data at the subject level. We computed a subject-specific status quo measure given by, very intuitively, the number of times the lottery 10-4 was chosen when it was the status quo, minus the number of times the lottery 10-4 was chosen under the neutral frame. So clearly, a subject behaving identically in the two parts would receive a measure of zero. A subject being status quo biased in that he chose 10-4 more often when it was the status quo would receive a measure above zero. Sorry. And this is the results. This is reporting the mean status quo bias measure by treatment. And as you can see, we do find status quo bias in 2 out of 4 treatments. The two treatments where we do find the bias are what we refer to as the asymmetric treatments, because they are cases where either the status quo is ambiguous or the alternative is ambiguous, but not both. Instead, As predicted by Bewley, for example, we do not find status quo bias in the risky-risky case, but we also do not find status quo bias, and this is very interesting, in the case where both the status quo is ambiguous and the alternative is ambiguous. So to make sure that these results are not driven by any outliers, I'm plotting here the full distribution of the status quo bias measure by treatment. And as you can see, the distribution is centered at zero in the two symmetric treatment and skewed to the right for positive value of the measure in the two asymmetric treatments. We also adopted a second econometric approach that had the advantage of dispensing us from having to compute any sort of arbitrary measure of status quo biasness, because here we treated each choice as a single observation, and we estimated a probit model for the probability that 10-4 was chosen. And what we looked at was the marginal effect of the status quo framing, which is a number, which is the answer to the following question. How much more likely is it that 10-4 is chosen when it is given as a status quo? And here is the answer to this question. It is 12% and 11% more likely that 10-4 is chosen when it is the status quo in the two asymmetric treatment. There is no incremental effect of giving 10-4 as a status quo on the probability of it being chosen in the two symmetric treatments. This approach also allowed us to compute the magnitude of the bias in terms of expected payoff. And this was done to make sure the size was not negligible in size. And in fact, it is not, because it corresponds to 10% of expected value. What it means is that if a subject is exhibiting indifference between option X and Y, say, out of side-by-side comparisons, and he is later endowed with X, in order to be indifferent again, he's going to ask for a premium on top of Y, which is equal to 10% of expected payoff Y. So it's a bias that is pretty big in size. Okay, so conclusions and interpretation. This is our finding. Notice that it is coherent with what Rocca and co-author found in 2006, in that they also did find a bias in the case of an ambiguous status quo and a risky alternative. But then notice also that our findings are not consistent with both the two theoretical models that I outlined earlier, because loss aversion was predicting status quo bias everywhere, and Bewley was predicting status quo bias everywhere except in the risky-risky case. So this is a sort of a puzzle. We need to understand what's going on. There seems to be yet a third pattern of choice that we have to try to rationalize in a way or another. Massimo?
The risk alternative. So for example, if it becomes certain.
That's a very good question.
Does it get magnified, the status quo?
So I'm going to conclude with that. We don't have direct evidence for that, but we can borrow from some other literature, and I'll give you an answer to that. So let's try to look at these findings, and let's try to make sense of them. So clearly, the idea of loss aversion is not really fitting, but perhaps the idea of incompleteness is. It's just that it's not quite captured by the mere presence of ambiguity as the generating factor of incompleteness. So let's walk through this road then, and let's assume that we believe in Bewley, in that we are going to see status quo bias everywhere there is some incompleteness of preferences, and we are not going to see the bias where preferences are complete. Then this would say that agents are able to compare two options that are risky, But they are also able to compare two options that are both ambiguous. And instead, they have some harder time at comparing options that are of different type of kind, if you want, in that one is a constant act and the other is a non-constant act. Does this story make sense? Is it plausible? Does it fit the intuition? Well, perhaps yes. Suppose, for example, that you have a decision maker that when he's faced with two ambiguous options, is going to abstract away from the state space and simply use some heuristic that aggregate the outcomes of the two bets, for example. Instead, when he's comparing a constant act with a non-constant act, he's going to have some harder time because the state space is entering in some asymmetric way, if you want. I'm being very sloppy and loose here, but because this is all work in progress and we are trying to interpret the results. So the last thing I wanted to tell you is related to Massimo's idea, and is that I'm going to show you something that strengthens, if you want, the belief that what we are after here is really a pattern and not just some random finding. Because I'm going to add a third dimension, which is the dimension of degenerate lotteries or money. And the reason why I can do that is because even though we don't have direct experimental evidence, because we didn't run that experiment, we can borrow from the literature on the willingness to pay, willingness to accept gap. Because that literature is really looking at how people choose between money and lotteries when they are either endowed with one or with the other. And if I look at the findings in that literature, we realize that there is a gap in choices between risky and ambiguous bets on one side and money on the other side. And instead, there is no gap in choices between money and essentially money, or tokens with assigned value. So if we incorporate these findings in our matrix, it becomes a 3x3 matrix now, and it's a matrix that looks like this. Where here I'm reporting the fact that there is no gap in choices between money and money, and here I'm reporting the fact that there is a gap in choices between money and either risky or ambiguous lotteries. With magnified, you mean in terms of size? So we didn't make that comparison. It's an interesting one. Yes, I don't have the answer now. Also because this literature is slightly different. They use a BDM approach to elicit the willingness to pay and willingness to accept. So it's not really clear that we can use those findings straight away up to the point to be able to make quantitative comparisons. But it's definitely a good idea, the one of incorporating a new treatment where we do run our own experiment when one of the two options is actually money. And that is a work in progress. But yes, as you can see, the pattern is now even stronger. You can see no status quo bias everywhere on the main diagonal when subjects are comparing objects of the same type, if you want, and status quo bias everywhere outside the main diagonal. So I guess this is the main takeout of my talk, and if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer to them.
Thanks very much. Georgia, are there questions? Yep.
Because the transition from the second row to the first row, if you control for the entropy of the lottery, so the lowest entropy would be the certain. So you should have something relating the entropy to the magnitude of the effect. That somehow, as you lower the entropy, the status quo should become stronger. because the status quo becomes sort of more appealing in some vague sense. And then the certain will be the limit case that will enrich the comparison of the two rows.
So
now they are just either risky or money, in the sense to make a smoother transition, if you parameterize it with the entropy, then you should be able to parameterize accordingly the magnitude of the effect. And then you
And maybe you can check if there is some discontinuity there.
Exactly.
Or not.
There is a smooth, I expect that there is a discontinuity at certainty.
At certainty.
So if I understood correctly your suggestion, but just so that I'm clear, is that your thought was that this could be consistent with Bewley if we took the view that subjects are able to compare objects of the same kind, as it were. And so, contrary to what we might have expected, they are actually able to compare to ambiguous bets, but they're unable to compare risky and ambiguous. So that's the kind of strategy, yeah. Yeah, that's. I mean, I think that's very interesting, actually. As a kind of consequence, I think it would have quite significant implications for theory of decision-making and ambiguity, because most of these theories imply, I mean, but I'm speaking very roughly here, that if you are able to compare two ambiguous, I mean, when the theory allows you to compare two ambiguous alternatives, it will allow you to compare two risky ones as well. I mean, it's sort of this, this asymmetry in the thing that the risky ones are always more comparable, as it were, than and this would suggest that that's not true. There may be sort of blowback, as it were, on the admissible theories of decision making and ambiguity for that reason.
Yeah. I guess what is interesting right now is to try to come up with a model that is able to generate this completeness versus incompleteness depending on where in the space you are at. And Bewley had a very straightforward way to do that, but we realize here it's not really fitting with the evidence. So it's actually going to be interesting to see if there is a way we can actually axiomatize this type of behavior and find ways in which we generate the areas of completeness and incompleteness that fit the evidence. Sure.
So one thing that was, kind of, from what it looked like from the examples you gave us, is that the ambiguous bets are sort of the same kind, right? I mean, that they're, so it would be kind of interesting if you were comparing things that are ambiguous but for completely different reasons. I mean, something that's got to do with urns and against something that's got to do with the stock market, against something that's got to do with, you know, virus mutating. Because I guess there's a sort of intuition that there the comparability might break down again.
That's a very good point. And it's one of the treatments that we will run in the fall, trying to break this idea of having both bets being ambiguous with the idea of having both bets being ambiguous and also so similar to each other, in a sense. We will break these two things by giving the subjects the choice between two options that are ambiguous but not so similar to each other in some loose sense, and see if we find a bias there or not.
Thanks very much, Georgia.